The Mark.
Part 12. The strange remark of Messiah about the kingdom of heaven being taken by violence and how the violent seize it by force must be taken in connection with John the Baptist and what Messiah says about him. It will be best, therefore, to quote in full the incident as recorded in Matthew. Now, when John heard in the prison the works of the Messiah, he sent by his disciples and said to them, Art thou he that cometh, or look we for another? And Yahshua answered and said unto them, Go your way, and tell John the things which ye do hear and see. The blind receive their sight, and the lame walk, the lepers are cleansed, and the deaf hear, and the dead are raised up, and the poor have good tidings preached to them. And blessed is he whosoever shall find none occasion of stumbling in me. And as these went their way, Yeshua began to say unto the multitudes concerning John, What went ye out into the wilderness to behold? A reed shaken by the wind? But what went ye out for to see? A man clothed in soft raiment? Behold, they that wear soft raiment are in kings' houses. But wherefore went ye out? To see the prophet? Yea, I say unto you, and much more than a prophet. This is he of whom it is written, Behold, I send my messenger before thy face, who shall prepare thy way before thee. Verily, I say unto you, among them that are born of women there hath not arisen a greater than John the Baptist. Yet he that is but little in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he. And from the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven suffereth violence, and men of violence take it by force. For all the prophets and the law prophesied until John, and if ye are willing to receive it, this is Eliah, which is to come. Matthew 11:2-14. First of all, note that Messiah said, from the time of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven suffereth violence, and men of violence take it by force. The phrase, until now, can only mean, until I, Messiah, came. It's clear that the path followed by John the Baptist was not the same as the teaching of Messiah, and this is implied all through the passage if we begin to grasp what was meant by such phrases as a reed shaken, kings, houses, soft raiment, and so on. We know that the Baptist was clad not in soft raiment, but in skins. John himself had his raiment of camel's hair and a leathern girdle about his loins. Matthew 3:4. And it is clear that Messiah refers to John the Baptist in a special way in saying that although he is the greatest of those born of women, the least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he. We can only understand this as meaning that the Baptist was on one level of understanding, but not on the level of understanding of the least in the kingdom of heaven. Therefore, that John's teaching was on a different level from the level of Messiah's teaching. John is surprised that Messiah's disciples do not fast, that they drink wine, and so on, while the Baptist's disciples fast and abstain. The disciples of John were sent to Messiah to ask, Why do we and the Pharisees fast often? Thy disciples fast not. So John doubts Messiah. Art thou indeed the Messiah? Matthew 11:3. The behavior of Messiah obviously worried the Baptist. He could not understand Messiah. He saw the attainment of the higher level of being, called the kingdom of heaven, as lying through violence to oneself, through abstinence, the keeping of rituals and fasts, the literal keeping of the word at all moments and under every circumstance. There was, no doubt, little mercy in his harsh outlook and harsh understanding of truth. His understanding perhaps rested on the literal meaning of the doctrines he followed. The Sabbath day was, perhaps, to him an exact literal observation of the commandment. Nothing must be done. No one must even be healed on the Sabbath. if he ever heard of Messiah's remark when accused by the literal-minded Pharisees of breaking the Sabbath, he would not have understood it. The Pharisees blamed Messiah's disciples for plucking and eating the ears of corn as they walked through the cornfields, saying, "Behold, why do they on the Sabbath day that which is not lawful?" They blamed Messiah for healing on the Sabbath. Messiah said to them, "The Sabbath was made for man, and not man for the Sabbath, a thing difficult to understand of many today." Mark 2:27. Up to the time of the appearance of John the Baptist, the kingdom of heaven had been prophesied as something that would come in the future. For all the prophets and the law prophesied until John, Matthew 11:13. But the Baptist, as a herald of Messiah, taught that the kingdom was now here, now present, immediate. It was a time of crisis. He cried, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand," meaning in the person of Messiah on earth. Why then did he not follow Messiah when Messiah came to be baptized by him? At one moment he seems to recognize Messiah, at another moment he seems to doubt. It has always been extraordinary to me that the Baptist, on meeting Messiah, did not unmistakably know him and follow him straight away, as Mark would have put it. Sometimes I have thought that Messiah was cold to John, that even he didn't like him. And yet, when the Baptist was beheaded for interfering with the marriage affairs of Herod, when Yeshua heard it, he withdrew from thence in a boat to a desert place apart. Matthew 14:13. No doubt that he gave John spirit force then for later, when Messiah was transfigured on the mountain. Did not Moses appear on one side of him and Eliah on the other? "Behold, there appeared unto them," that is the disciples, "Moses and Eliah talking with him." Matthew 17:3. And had not Messiah already told his disciples concerning John, "If ye will receive it, this is Eliah, which is to come." Matthew 11:14. It is almost as if Messiah did not want to work on him in life, but did his work on him after his physical death, when he could reach him better. Certainly, at the Transfiguration, John was no longer wearing skins and leather, but was clad in light. It is said in one gospel, "There talked with him two men, which were Moses and Eliah, who appeared in glory." Luke 9:30. We know that by withdrawal and long meditation, we can give force to another person, for this is one form of intelligent sacrifice. How much more, then, could Messiah do this to both the physical living and dead? Did he not give force to Peter living, where Luke records that Messiah said to Peter, "Shimon, Shimon, behold, Satan asked to have you, that he might sift you as wheat. But I made supplication for thee, that thy faith fail not. And do thou, when once thou hast turned, establish thy brethren." Luke 22:31. See thus, there is John the Baptist, the greatest of men born of women, but not in the kingdom of heaven. And John the Baptist, transfigured by Messiah, and so in the kingdom, no more a man born of woman, but a man reborn, and so beyond violence. Did not Messiah say to his mother, "Woman, what have I to do with thee?" when he had reached that level of inner development, the outer sign of which was his power to transform water into wine? To take the word of the law literally is to do violence to others and to oneself. The literal sense, say, of a parable, doesn't convey its inner levels and meaning. Literal truth is without mercy, grace, or charity, and can be most crude and most violent in its results, as we see in religious persecutions. The harsh clothing of the Baptist is contrasted with the soft raiment of those who live in king's palaces. A man is clothed psychologically in the things he follows. The mind is clothed in the truths it holds to. To change one's mind, that is to have metanoia, is to clothe it anew with new thoughts, new truths. John the Baptist taught this metanoia. It is translated as repent, but it means change your mind. Yet Taking his clothing as representing his teaching, he is shown in harsh vesture. Living in the wilderness, he cried, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." Here we can understand that this metanoia, this change of mind, had reference to the fact that the kingdom of heaven was an actuality and that men had to begin to think of their meaning on earth in view of this supreme selective kingdom, far more important than any kingdom on earth. John didn't know the teachings of Messiah, but he was the first to say that the kingdom of heaven is not in the future, but now. There are then three teachings here about the kingdom. The prophet spoke of things that were to come. The kingdom was to come in the future. The Baptist said the kingdom is at hand, and so was greater than the prophets. Yea, said Messiah of him, and much more than a prophet. And Messiah later said, kingdom of heaven is among you. That is not in the future or in some locality, a thing which perhaps the Baptist had not grasped. For external literal truth doesn't grasp internal psychological spiritual truth. Yes, heaven is not a place above, and hell is not below in space. Heaven and hell are within a man. So we notice that the conception of the kingdom lay first in the future in time, then as being present in time and space, and finally as being in a man himself apart from external time and space. In thinking of these two most enigmatic figures, to me, in the Gospels, John the Baptist and Judas Iscariot, I have often wondered what the Baptist would have thought of the many parables Messiah used to illustrate what the kingdom of heaven is, usually beginning with the words, "The kingdom of heaven is likened unto." No doubt with this harsh literal conceptions of truth, the Baptist thought of the kingdom as a place that one had to take by force, by some tremendous effort over the flesh, by every sort of self-denial. But if so, Messiah says that this is not the way. The harshness is no good. It's not the way into the kingdom. Messiah asked whether in going to see the Baptist in the wilderness, where his food was locusts and wild honey, the people expected to see something weak, a reed shaken by the wind. If so, they were wrong. The Baptist was strong as a man born of woman, which is the first birth. But all esoteric religion teaches a second birth, as did Messiah when he said, "Ye must be born again from above." Are we to think that John realized this? Are we to imagine from what Messiah says of him that he had grasped what can take a man into the kingdom? Seems to me that the answer is no. He thought that, as he was, a natural man, a man born of woman, he could take the kingdom of heaven by violence to his appetites. And it seems that for a brief period this was possible. From the time of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom suffereth violence, but certainly not after. In bringing in this contrast to the Baptist's harsh method, Messiah speaks of those clad in soft raiment. They, he implies, are in the kingdom. They were capable of understanding far beyond the rigid literal word, and where the Baptist saw only one thing, they saw a thousand things. They were flexible, not rigid. Their understanding was not keeping literally a law. They had mercy, charity, and above all, relative thinking. They were, in brief, on another level of understanding, wider, more intelligent and gracious, where narrow, rigid truth no longer was put before the lovely wideness of goodness, but where the marriage of truth and good had taken place within them, so that literal truth was never allowed to go before goodness, and so where no one could do non-goodness in the name of the truth, and no one could hate or kill his neighbor in the name of literal truth. For if you put a narrow, rigid truth before goodwill and goodness, you are clad as the Baptist, in harsh skins and leather, and the food of your goodness is locusts and wild honey, and your dwelling place is the wilderness barren of all life. So we find in the Gospel of John, which has nothing to do with John the Baptist, that Jesus is described by the beloved disciple in these terms, "And we beheld him full of grace and truth." Yes, grace first, and truth from grace after. End of part 12. No, not the end. This is not the end. Where was I? Now a comment from me. This last few paragraphs is in itself one of the greatest truths I have ever heard. It flies in the face of those who would make others do things with threats or on account of the Bible or to stay in good graces within the assembly. And because there has been no metanoia in the assembly, I have met perhaps hundreds of people in the last few years that have left the church for that very reason, and now are leaving Hebraic-type assemblies because they have found that this harsh, violent way has done them great harm. It will help you to listen to this episode again. That's the end of my observation. One therefore asks, if the kingdom of heaven is the kingdom of heaven, if it is within or among us, some conscious state of understanding that is sometimes open and sometimes shut, then one might easily say, if this is so, can people press into it only at different times in the world's history? I would add, is this then the good news? The evangelio? The news? Evangelio? Namely, that now a man, a woman, may enter because in the flux of things, the doors happen to be open? Do you remember the man who got into the kingdom of heaven wrongly? I quote from the parable of the marriage feast. When the king came in to behold the guests, he saw there a man which had not on a wedding garment, and he said unto him, "Friend, how earnest thou in hither not having a wedding garment?" And he was speechless. Then the king said to the servants, "Bind him hand and foot, and cast him into the outer darkness. There shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth, for many are called, but few chosen." Matthew 22:11-14. One can see that this man had not at least the soft raiment that Messiah spoke of. Sheer, unmerciful truth is not a wedding garment. A relaxing and releasing thought to many brought up under an interpretation of Messiah's teaching based solely on literal truth with no inner mercy and no goodwill and no trace of psychological understanding. Is it not extraordinary how the literal word-for-word meaning is still upheld without the slightest idea that this is not enough and is not real understanding, and that in such an interpretation of Messiah, such a man, causing endless perplexity and pain to others, has no wedding garment and is destined to be turned out of the kingdom? Is it too much to say that such a man, so formidable in the literal interpretation of truth, who theorizes from pulpits, a man who perhaps condemns everyone, who regards man as made for the Sabbath, and refuses to believe that the Sabbath was made for a man, is one who, having no grace or inner charity or human kindness, and so no wedding garment, is nothing but a man of self-will and violence and not a man at all in the sense of Messiah. It is just as if people might imagine that by going to church regularly all their lives, they are already in the kingdom of God. Elohim, is it not clear that this cannot be the case, and that metanoia and rebirth is the essential and real meaning of all that Messiah taught, and that no one is in a real sense a Christian, and it worse still, that so many think they are so? Only Messiah himself was a Christian. Why? Because he united perfectly in himself the human mother side with the divine side and rendered the connection between heaven and earth open again at a stage in human history when all connection was being lost and mankind was being cut off from all higher values and so higher direction. End of part 12.